بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على أشرف الأنبياء سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. قال المصنف رحمه الله تعالى ونفعنا الله تعالى به: حي لا يموت قيوم. دي أوتا الإمام أبو جعفر أحمد بن محمد الطحاوي رحمه الله states in his work Bayanu Sunnati wal Jama'a. The title of the work is Bayanu Sunnati wal Jama'a. Hayyun, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is living. La yamutu, does not die. Qayyumun, self-subsisting or sustaining. Hayyun literally would mean life. But when referring to creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, life is in reference to the heart beating, the blood flowing around the body, and the indwelling of the spirit inside of a body. This meaning does not apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any word, the outward meaning of which alludes to or indicates to anthropomorphism or any likeness to creation is negated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when the author states Hayyun, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is living, we would say hiya sifatun azaliyatun qa'imatun bi dhatihi ta'ala. This is an eternal attribute that is established with the entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an eternal attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By this attribute, we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-powerful. We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-knowing. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not have this divine attribute of living, then it would be impermissible for him to have power. It would be impermissible for him to have knowledge. It would be impermissible for him to have irada, divine will. Each attribute has a ta'alluq, a connection. For instance, sifatul qudra, the divine power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will have a connection to maqdur, those things which are overwhelmed or are under the power, divine power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or for instance, sifatul irada, the divine will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will be connected to al-murad, the intended thing. So, in this way, each attribute has a connection to something. But the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of al-hayatu, divine life, is not connected to anything. The attribute of divine life is not connected to anything. However, it is a rational condition. It is a rational condition for the divine existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can you have divine existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without divine life? Therefore, it's a rational condition for the divine existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, note how the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, has left out sifatul wujud, the attribute of divine existence. The reason for this is because in Al-Qur'an al-Kareem, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned how the prophets and messengers alayhimu salatu wassalam would address the nations. قَالَتْ رُسُلُهُمْ, their messengers said, أَفِي اللَّهِ شَكٌ فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Their messengers said, this is in Surah to Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, verse 10, that their messengers said, is there doubt, afillahi shakkun, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fatir as-samawati wal-ard, the originator, or the one who gives, the originator of the heavens and the earth. This word fatir, Sayyidina Abdullah bin Abbas radiyallahu anhuma wanted to know the meanings of the word Fatir. And how Sayyiduna Abdullah bin Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, who is known as Hibrul Ummah, the learned scholar of this nation, And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam supplicated for him, Allahumma faqihu fi ddeen wa 'allimhu at-ta'wil. O Allah, give him superlative understanding and in religion, and give him, teach him correct interpretation, at-ta'wil. So the word ta'wil, interpretation of the Quran, is used from the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Unlike what the pseudo-Salafi movement would want us to believe, that ta'wil is impermissible. But traditional Sunni scholarship has always taken ta'wil into consideration. عَلِّمْهُ ta'wil. Oh Allah, teach him ta'wil. He wanted to know the meaning of the word fatara, and he saw two Bedouins disputing over a well. One of the Bedouins said, أَنَا فَتَرْتُهَا. The other one said, أَنَا فَتَرْتُهَا, which means, I started this well, I dug the well, I started this well. The word is fatara. So the meaning of fatir is samawati wal ard, would be the one who originated the heavens and the earth. So based upon this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also states, وَلَا إِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولَنَّ اللَّهِ. That if you ask them, مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, who created the heavens and the earth, they shall definitely say that it is Allah. Why is this? Because the very divine existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in the nature of human beings, knowing the divine existence, fitratul khalq. And this is the meaning of the hadith, kullu mauludin yuladu ala al-fitrati, that every born child is born upon al-fitra, the natural disposition which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. What is this natural disposition? Is to know the divine existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Imam Ja'far as-Sadiq rahimahullah ta'ala states that when people are in distress and they are on a boat or something like a boat and are drowning, their innate nature will call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can have the greatest atheist and place him in a disaster on an aeroplane. His natural, in his nature, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created him, is that he will call out to his divine creator. Kullu mawliudin yuladu ala al-fitrati, that every child that is born upon this fitrah. Later on in the hadith, فَأَبَوَاهُ يُهَوِّدَانِهِ, that his parents will make him either a Jew, or يُنَصِّرَانِهِ, or they'll make him a Christian, or يُمَجِّسَانِهِ, or they will make him a fire worshipper, whatever religion he may follow. So therefore, this is also used by atheists as an argument that the Muslims today are only Muslims because their parents have brought them up as Muslims. But as we mentioned in the beginning of these lessons and in the Sunusi creed, that once a person passes the age of maturity, he must know the divine existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his rational mind. If he does not know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his rational mind, in accordance with his ability, in accordance with the capability Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him, then he becomes sinful. He becomes sinful for not knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if he chooses to do blind conformity, to conform, then according to the majority of the scholars, he is sinful. A small minority of them said his faith is not accepted. The preferred opinion is that he is sinful for doing blind conformity. So this objection of the atheists will not apply to the Muslims, because on the Day of Judgment, so many people will be resurrected who outwardly lived as Muslims, and we will see that throughout their lives they did not believe in Islam, which in Islamic terminology, these people are known as munafiqun, hypocrites. Not hypocrites in action. Commonly today, the term hypocrite is used for someone, he may not practice outward Islam, and people will refer to him as a hypocrite because he may preach Islam. But even in such a case, the person is still a mu'min, a believer. When we use the word munafiq in its severity, in its true meaning, the meaning of the word munafiq in its severity and true meaning is a person who does not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if he does outward actions in accordance with Islam. So the messengers, Rusul alayhi salatu wasalam, they guided people toward tawheed. So people by their fitrah, natural disposition, believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the messengers alayhi salatu wasalam guided them toward the divine attributes, al-wahdaniya, oneness, al-qudra, divine power, al-mukhalafatu lil-hawadith, opposition to contingent things. This is why the author states, hayyun, living, and la yamutu, he does not die. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not die. Why? What is the very definition of death? The very definition of death is mufaraqatu ruhi anil badan, or al-jism, the separation of the soul from the body. Once the soul has been separated from the body becomes dead. The person is considered dead. But even though we may use this term death, kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut, every soul shall taste death. Does the spirit die when the angels extract the soul from the body? The answer is no, because the soul will either be transported to Illiyin, the highest point, which is in paradise, or the soul shall be transported to Sijjin, which is the lowest point located in hellfire. The very location of paradise is on the right hand side of Sidratul Muntaha, the right hand side of the furthest lot tree. Sidratul Muntaha is a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the right hand side is paradise. Within paradise is located Illiyin. In Illiyin, the souls are placed of pious people. In Sijjin, hellfire is located under the seventh earth. What do we mean by seventh earth? Seven earth-like planets, including earth. Under the seventh earth, located underneath the seventh earth, is hellfire. Within hellfire is Sijjin, where the souls of the disbelievers are placed. Some scholars took the opinion that the souls of the pious people are placed in Zamzam well, in the black stone. Other opinions also mentioned, like the souls of the disbelievers are placed in a well in Yemen. And some scholars even mentioned that they went to the well and they could hear the souls and spirits. But the valid view is that the pious souls are placed in Illiyin and the disbelievers are placed in Sijjin. As for a believer, a mu'min, a person who has faith, but his actions are not good, he is left, his soul is left floating in Sama'ud Dunya. In Sama'ud Dunya. This is once the soul has been extracted. When the body has been placed in the grave, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala re-establishes a connection, a weak connection compared to worldly life, between the body and the soul. And this connection is known as Alamul Barzakh, the intermediary stage, the isthmus life of those in the intermediary stage in the grave. This is known as Alamul Barzakh, similar to sleeping. If you watch and observe the dead body, you will see nothing. But what the person and the soul is experiencing is known as Alamul Barzakh, like observing a sleeping person, and the sleeping person may observe so many things. This meaning of death does not apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if he died, then this it would entail that everything, the Nidhamul Kaun, which is the sustaining of the universe, keeping order in the universe, would finish. Now the Christians believe that Sayyiduna Isa alayhi salam is one of three persons of one substance: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. This in effect would mean each one of these individuals, persons, is an attribute, a divine attribute of the divine substance, the divine entity. Three different individuals. If God the Son died on the cross for the sins of humanity, in effect they believe that an attribute of God died. So they would say God the Father and God the Holy Spirit were alive, but God the Son, one of the manifestations of the divine, remained and sacrificed himself for the sins of humanity. In one debate with Christians, I pointed out to them that our Lord does not need a sacrifice to forgive our sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need our blood to forgive our sins. In fact, a person, a Muslim who commits a sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not, or the angels are ordered not to write down his sins until 6 worldly hours have transpired. In case that person repents from his sin. But if he intends to do a good deed, the angels are ordered to write down 1 good deed. When he carries out the good deed, 10 good deeds are written down. If after 6 hours, after committing a sin, the person does not repent, the angels only write down 1 bad deed. If he has good deeds, those good deeds erase the bad deeds. So even without repentance on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the angels place the good deeds in the scales in order to erase the bad deeds. This is how much forgiveness there is in Islam. Then there are sins between the person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in most and majority of cases, forgives those sins which are between the person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sins which there is strictness in are the sins which involve the rights of other human beings. So, and the rights of creation. If the person has a sin which involves the right of creation, then there is strictness. So if there is an individual who has iman, faith, belief, all his life he has not violated any rights of creation, and he has laxity in his worship between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a very strong chance of his forgiveness. Now the Christians at this point will say a chance is insufficient. When we use this word chance, the reason for saying the word chance is not to encourage people to commit sins. Because if we said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely forgive him, this will encourage some people to carry out more sins. In order to disencourage people, we say there is a chance of them being forgiven. In reality, we know every Muslim will be forgiven, because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Shafa'ati li ahli al-kaba'iri min ummati," my intercession is for the people of major sins from my nation. So even the people who will stay in hellfire for a short portion of time, their punishment will be alleviated and removed. So this is glad tidings for humanity, that Christians should leave Christian doctrine and come toward Islam, accept Islam and understand Islam in its true manner, in the way Islam was explained by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we say la yamutu, he does not die. Sayyiduna Isa alayhi salam did not die on the cross for our sins. For our sins to be forgiven, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need blood sacrifice. So one of them said, then in the Hajj, why do you have sacrifice in the Hajj? I mentioned to him the verse in Surah Al-Hajj, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions very clearly that the blood and the meat does not reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the piety of the heart. We know if a person performs Hajj Mufrid, a person who lives in Makkah al-Mukarramah performs Hajj Mufrid, his Hajj, does he have to give a sacrifice? No. A person who cannot afford a sacrifice, what does he do? He fasts for 10 days. Yes? 3 days in Makkah al-Mukarramah and 7 days later. Whatever the legal ruling is, he fasts to make up for the absence of a sacrifice. Therefore, it's not the blood and the meat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. It is the piety. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ, that the one who comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a sound heart. But this does not do away with observance of legal rulings, because Christians claim legal rulings, the fetters that were upon the Jews were removed, and they do not practice outward legal rulings. But in Islam, the outward legal rulings were maintained, but the forgiveness and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was also mentioned. خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. That human beings have been created weak. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created them weak. With the weakness of sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made abundant ways of forgiving sins. Simply, a sinner, if he goes to a room and supplicates to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive my sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him. And any rights relating to creation, he makes amends regarding the rights of other human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him. Therefore, when we say la yamutu, he does not die, Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam would not have had to die for the sins of humanity. One of them, I said to him, if Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam died for the sins of humanity, he must have died for the sin of disbelief. Meaning, they make it a condition, you must believe Jesus died for your sins for you to have salvation. Therefore, Jesus did not die for the entire sins of humanity. Because one of the greater sins, according to them, is the denial of Jesus' crucifixion. So therefore, Jesus did not die for every sin. He died for most sins. At this point, the opponent did not have an answer to this point. So, la yamutu, this cannot apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he dies, or that any one of the divine attributes perishes away or is finished. Because we mentioned, la yafna wa la yabid, he does not perish, la yafna wa la yabid, and he is not destroyed. This does not apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qayyumun, now, the attributes here that have been mentioned, this qayyum is from al-asma'ul husna, from the beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone asked, is al-qadim mentioned in the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The answer is yes. There are references for the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-qadim. In the same way, Al-Qayyum, we know the hadith, لِلَّهِ تِسْعَةٌ وَتِسْعُونَ إِسْمًا, that for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, 99 names. In one version of the hadith in At-Tirmidhi, there are different names mentioned. In the other versions, different names are mentioned. Why? وَلَهُ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى, for him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, are the beautiful names. Al-Husna, the form of the word Al-Husna, is such a form in Arabic that it indicates towards abundant, endless names. They are not limited to 99. That the divine attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not limited to 20. In the same way, the divine names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not limited to 99. But the hadith is mentioning the virtue of memorizing the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So qayyum. The meaning of Qayyum is the one who is established by himself without the assistance of anyone else. The philosophical term for this, aseity, A-S-E-I-T-Y, aseity of God, meaning God is self-subsistent, he does not need anyone. This is why later as we will go, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, that the merciful rose above the throne. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of the throne. The throne is in need of him. So the meaning of the verse is not that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is carried in a tangible, physical, corporeal sense by the throne. This is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The meaning would be that istawa, rising on the throne, is a divine action of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which does not have a physical, tangible, corporeal aspect to it. A person cannot think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like a body. This is an impossibility. So, Qayyumun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is self-established, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who sustains everyone else. Everything is sustained. Someone asked a question, If we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everlasting, then what is the difference between the divine attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being everlasting and hellfire and paradise? Because hellfire and paradise will last forever. Hellfire and paradise will last forever. The difference between the two is that hellfire and paradise have a beginning. And we mention anything that has a beginning will have an end. So the questioner asked, if paradise and hellfire have a beginning, then they must have an end. The answer to this is that hellfire and paradise are always sustained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never sustained by anything. He's qayyum, self-subsistent. Hellfire and paradise are always sustained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at every given moment. In the way fire burns, the nature of burning in fire is always created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sustains that nature. Now, the extinguishing of hellfire, we will cover in a later lesson when we reach the passages relating to the subsistent burning, continuous burning of hellfire, and the logicality of why disbelievers will burn in hellfire forever. Because people ask, why will disbelievers burn in hellfire forever? What is the logicality of this? This we will cover when we get to the hellfire. And there are not three valid opinions within Islam on this. The valid opinion is that hellfire will be sustained forever, for eternity. So, when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is qayyum, this also means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tadbir and hifz for His creation. Tadbir, divine planning. Hifz, protection. If you, every individual observes their own life, they will be able to extract those moments where they saw the divine planning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguarded them. For instance, in 2008, I was in Syria. I wanted to buy a house in Syria. A relative of one of my teachers, he offered a house for £30,000 in the old city. The offer did not, I had the money ready. The offer did not go through. Why? Because the Syrian government did not allow my visa to be extended, and therefore I was unable to buy the house. Returning back from Syria in 2008, in 2011, a civil war started in Syria. See the divine planning? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is just a simple experience, but imagine those people who are in actual situations like the people in Syria today. Imagine the refugees in the camps. Those young children who have no shoes and are walking in snow. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a divine plan for them also. Those refugees who have been forced into prostitution, those refugees who have been forced into situations, even for them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a divine plan. Of course, this also relates to the problem of evil, because some people will say, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a divine plan for them, why is there the existence of evil? And as previously mentioned, we can go into the fact that much of evil, or what is termed as evil, is done by human beings themselves. Then someone may say, why does not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intervene? Even the intervention will say, momentarily, فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. Momentarily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not intervening according to those who are observing. But in the long run, the divine wisdom will be the divine wisdom will be observable for all to see on the Day of Judgment and on the face of the earth. فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. That give some time to the disbelievers. فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. Ruwayda also means a period of time, that this despotic behavior that we see, this common oppression we see amongst human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given human beings free will on earth. They can do anything they want within their ability with free will, for as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them free will. But when the batsh, the divine punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not leave any tyrant. So tyranny is not only the tyranny of the rulers, tyranny is also what fellow human beings, civilians do with one another. Human trafficking, prostitution. These type of human sins which are occurring now within the world, these are from the effects of the behavior of humanity. So Qayyumun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sustaining the universe, is not only observed through the divine attribute of Qayyum. There are so many divine attributes, we observe the effect of those attributes within our world today. Like Latif, the subtle. Latif, the subtle. Who carries the aeroplane in the skies with subtlety that hundreds of passengers are within the aeroplane and the aeroplane is able to land safely on earth? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not human beings. Human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the minds to be able to create shuttles and aeroplanes by which they are able to go out into space. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alluded to this, indicated towards this in Surah Ar-Rahman regarding fanfudhu, that go out into the what aqtar as-samawati wal ard, in the different portions of the heavens and the earth. Yet you will only be able to do illa bi sultan, with the divine power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not of your own accordance. So la yanamu qayyumun la yanam, qayyum, the one who is self-subsisting and sustains everyone. La yanam, he does not sleep. Now in ayatul kursi, la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wala nawm, does not take him what sinatun wala nawm. Nawm is what? Sleep. La yanam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not sleep. What is nawm? How they define sleep in the old books is they mentioned that it's a state which is caused by the relaxation of all the nerves and tendons of a creature, of the mind, and the moisture reaches the brain, which comes out from the body, and this moisture reaches the brain, and then the person will fall asleep, unaware, negligent of his surroundings. The reason for why this is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is obvious to all. La yanam, because if he subhanahu wa ta'ala slept or rested, then he subhanahu wa ta'ala will not have the attributes of qayyum, of the one who sustains, qudra, divine power, and so many other divine attributes. The Yahud, Jews, were anthropomorphists. They, when they tampered the Torah, one of the tamperings of the Torah that they placed was that when God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, he rested on the seventh day. So in the book of Genesis, you will find this tampering of the Torah that they mentioned resting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were anthropomorphists also because they believed Sayyiduna Ya'qub alayhi salam wrestled God Almighty. This is why he was given the name, according to them, Israel. According to them, that the name is because he wrestled God Almighty. That God Almighty came in human form. Sayyiduna Ya'qub alayhi salam, according to them, wrestled the man. He thought it was a man until the morning, and then it was realized that the man was not a man but God Almighty himself. This is why the progeny of those people who tampered the Bible believe that they are the super race, the race which is untouchable. Why? Because they were able to wrestle with God Almighty, similar to Gog and Magog, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. How? Because Ya'juj and Ma'juj will fire arrows into the sky and they will say, we have killed whoever is on the face of the earth, let us kill the one who is in the heavens. Again, anthropomorphic beliefs, believing God is located in space and time, by believing God is up there. So they will fire arrows and the arrows will come down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order the angels to place blood and they will be deceived out of their own doing, because otherwise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deceive in the sense human beings understand, meaning when someone attempts to deceive God Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns that deception upon them. We do not ascribe deception to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is known as mushakala in ilm al-balagha. So they will fire arrows, the arrows will come back down with red. Similar to this, some people have that mentality today, that they are able to counter God Almighty and they are a super race. While in Islam, we don't have a super race. There is no super race. In fact, in Islam, no race has dominance over another race. Yes, there are aspects which were mentioned, like the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that the leadership shall remain in Quraysh. But he also said, Ali salatu wasalam, as mentioned in Al-Jami al-Saghir, that the adhan, the call to prayer, shall remain in Habasha, in Africa. That the Africans should be given precedence in giving adhan, call to prayer. So the virtues of every nation were mentioned in Islam. Not one nation has virtue over the other. We don't have a concept of goyim. The concept of goyim, non-Jews who are seen as inferior, no. According to Islam, whether a person is a Jew, whether a person is from any other race of humanity, they are all equal. Every race is equal. So la yanam, he does not sleep. This again goes to anthropomorphic beliefs, holding a concept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be described with human descriptions, with human attributes. Khaliqun bila hajatin, creator without need. What does this refer to? Some people believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a need to create. Based upon that need, he creates. This mistake is repeated by so many people in sermons where they say foolish things like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was in need to create the light of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is impermissible to say. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is khaliqun bila hajatin, creator without need. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where he states, ma khalaqtul jinna wal insa illa liya'budun, I did not create jinn and jinn kind and humankind, illa liya'budun, here would mean except that I ordered them to worship me. The meaning would not be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a need of their worship. And this is also an objection of atheists. Atheists commonly ask, why does God Almighty need us to worship Him? The response to this objection would be, God Almighty does not need us to worship Him, we need to worship Him, and we have been ordered to worship Him. Why have we been ordered to worship Him? The question must be rephrased. Why has God Almighty ordered humanity to worship Him? The response to this objection would be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the people He has tasked to worship, are they children? No. Are they mad people? No. Are they the physically handicapped? The answer is no. The people who have been tasked to worship are those people who have been given ability to do things on earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them some power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them some intellect. With this power and intellect, a human being can build roads, build cameras, build different things. If this human being did not have a divine law, this human being will begin to think of himself as God Almighty. Like Nimrod thought of himself as God Almighty, building a tower, which is known as the Tower of Babel. Why was it known as Babel? Because this is where the word babbling is from. That after what's mentioned in the Bible is that after the tower was destroyed, the people start speaking in tongues, and this is where the term babbling comes from. But the Tower of Babel, the purpose of the tower was to challenge God Almighty. Even Fir'aun in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that he intended to create a tower. He ordered Haman, build for me a tower that I may observe the God of Musa alayhi salam, because Fir'aun was an anthropomorphist as well. If you look through history, they had an anthropomorphic concept of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like humans or similar to humans, or has some resemblance to humans, or has human attributes. So, خَالِقٌ بِلَا حَاجَةٍ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ would mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created humanity and ordered them to worship Him, ordered them to worship Him for their own benefit. Why? Because the Sharia is masalih. Masalih is the benefits of the entire humankind. There are benefits in Sharia. What do those benefits cover? They will cover the religion of a person, the life, the wealth, the mind, and the honor of an individual. Any law of Sharia that you will observe will protect these five things. This is known as maqasidu sharia, the purpose of the Sharia. So when we say khaliqun bila hajatin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates, but He subhanahu wa ta'ala has no need of that creation. And a common objection is, why does not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sustain us directly with that means? That instead we have means. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created this world with asbab, means. Why do we not have food entering our mouth or energy entering our body, strength entering our body without the means of food? The response to that would be that when we observe the clouds, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala moves the clouds, rain comes out of those clouds, the rain falls down on the earth, crops come out. From those crops, human beings take wheat and barley and make bread. That bread reaches us through hundreds of hands, bakers, transporters, shopkeepers, and we see the effect of the divine power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We observe the effect of the divine power. If it were not for asbab, means, we would not observe the divine power in action, that the effect of the divine power, the actions which are taking place around us. So next week, inshallah, we shall cover raziqun lahum, that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is sustainer. Further down, there is also a discussion regarding the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the eternalness of the divine attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a discussion of the difference between the Ash'ari school and the Maturidi school. And after this, further down, there is لا يحتاج إلى شيء ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. When we reach that passage, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, we will be refuting pseudo-modern Salafism and the claims of pseudo-modern Salafism, where they claim that the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which is the Asha'ira, they negate the divine attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by negating likeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to creation. This discussion we shall have further down in the lessons. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to attend and create the means for us to attend.